What a year. And by the way, today is the last, or we're getting close to the last day of 2019, but do you know that on the first, it's not the start of a new decade? Do you guys know that? We don't start the new decade until 2021. A zero holds a space open, but that's the end. It's not the start of a new series of 10. I just thought you needed to know that. Okay, so take your Bibles, go to Romans chapter 12. We're going to be looking at a passage, one of my favorite in all of Scripture, and it's a great passage to look at as we are anticipating a new year, and next year, a new decade. But while you're turning there, I just want to start with a story. When I was in the eighth grade at Nathan Eckstein Junior High School in Seattle, Washington, my dad would drive me and a couple of neighborhood kids to church or to school. We'd get there kind of early, you know, because he had to get to work earlier than when our school started. We'd get there a little early. And so I'm walking around the halls of Nathan Eckstein, just saying hi to my friends and hanging out and doing nothing. And I had one of my friends come up to me and say, "Hey, Mike, are you going to Hawaii?" And I said, I don't think so. About 10 minutes later, I had another friend that come up and say, "I hear you're going to Hawaii." I said, "Yes, good morning to you too." Strangest thing, by the end of the day, I had no less than 7 of my friends ask me if I was going to Hawaii. So when I got home, I said, "Hey, Mom, are we going to Hawaii?" She said, "No," and she laughed. She said, "No, we're not, but your grandmother is." My grandmother's name, Helen Vanlaningham. My grandmother, we used to call her Grammy Helen. Grammy Helen entered sort of a raffle thing at the Seattle Post-Intelligencer newspaper. And she got selected for an all-vacation-paid, all-expenses-paid trip to Hawaii for 10 days. Now, my grandmother was a widow at this time, and so she decided to go. But she had to respond within 48 hours. This was published in the Seattle PI that she had actually won this. Her name was there. That's how my friends knew about it. And she had a phone number in the newspaper that was put there with the article that she won that she had to call and respond within 48 hours or she wasn't going to be able to go. Well, she did respond. Because she was a widow, she took my two maiden aunts, her two sisters, gals who had never been married, good Christian gals who I knew and grew up with, and the three of them went to Hawaii. You've heard of the odd couple? This was the odd triple. It really was. But they had a great time. But if she hadn't responded by calling that number, she would have been in big trouble. Guess what? Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, is how we ought to respond correctly to everything that God has done for us. So we're going to take a look here. I think in order to be able to do so very, very quickly, I want to review a couple of things in the book of Romans. And I love the book of Romans. So in the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul lays out in the early chapters the spiritual condition of the non-Christian world. That the non-Christian world is under the wrath and condemnation of God because of its sin. Sin is violating God's laws, and part of that involves treating other people badly. And just doing things we shouldn't do that God isn't pleased with. He goes then from there to talk about what the solution to that problem is. If we are under God's wrath because of our sin, and we got there because of our action, how do we fix that? Well, there's nothing we can do. But the Apostle Paul says that God has provided a solution to that issue. He sent his Son of God, the second member of the divine Trinity. He came to earth, lived a sinless life, died on the cross for our sins as a sacrifice. He took our place when he died on the cross. He voluntarily allowed himself to be punished by God for the sins that we've committed. And the Bible says that as long as we trust in him, if we will trust in him for the forgiveness of our sins, God does forgive us, and he gives us eternal life and a place in heaven with him forever and ever. After he talks about the solution to our sin problem, Paul goes on then and describes some of the amazing results of that for us. We can have a life of joy, even in the midst of real hardship that we're experiencing. We can have life in the Holy Spirit. We do have life in the Holy Spirit. And what a huge privilege it is to have the Spirit dwelling within us, empowering us, giving us new life, giving us hope. That's one of the results of being right with the Lord through Jesus. In Romans chapters 9, 10, and 11, the Apostle Paul talks about what's going on with Israel. It looks like God made promises to Israel in the Old Testament. But at that particular time, it also looked like God had set Israel aside and that he wasn't really working with the Jewish people anymore. And instead, he's working with a predominantly Gentile church, not Israel. And Paul says, no, that's not the case. God is still keeping his promises to the people of Israel, and he will keep them. If he didn't, then he's unfaithful to his word, because he said in the Old Testament he was royally going to bless them and pour out his mercy upon them and establish them as a nation through whom he would manifest his greatness to the world. None of that had happened yet, not by Paul's day, not yet in our day, but God's going to do that someday. Starting in chapter 12 and going through chapter 16, the Apostle Paul sort of begins to deal with the practical implications of all of this. What's the right way for us to respond in light of all of this amazing stuff that he has done for us? That's Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. What we're going to find here is that the Apostle Paul will discuss the obligations that we have toward the Lord as a result of being right with him. And those three obligations, we are to present ourselves to God. We're going to be looking at these in a second. We need to be transformed in our minds and renewed. And we need to experience God's amazing will and word for our lives. Those are the three things. So here's the first thing in verse 1. We need to be presenting ourselves to God. This is the right way to respond to him in light of all of his goodness to us. So he says in chapter 12 and verse 1, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God. That word mercies means a display of concern over another person's misfortune. And notice here that the word mercies is plural. God doesn't just show his love and his concern in one way. He shows it in a score of ways, in thousands of different ways, especially. He shows his mercies to us in Christ, as we've already seen. So he says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. I want to stop there just for a second. Now, there are going to be a couple of times here in my message where I'm going to refer to grammar. I used to be a high school English teacher. And most of you are going to go, oh, no. And so the grammar is actually really helpful on occasion. So we're going to show you some things. Here's one of the things. When Paul says, I appeal to you to present, that to present is not exactly a command verb. Not exactly. But it is sort of. If a general says to a private, I order you to fight the enemy. If you drop the phrase, I order you, what are you left with? Fight the enemy. That's what you're left with. And that's a command. What Paul does here is a real pastoral way, a really kind way, of ordering the Romans to present themselves to God. It is a virtual imperative verb. And if it's a virtual imperative verb, then it's something that you and I must do. It's not an optional thing. So what is it exactly that we're supposed to do? He says, we are to present our bodies. The word present here is used in the Old Testament in a number of different places for a servant or an inferior coming to his superior or his boss and presenting himself to do what his boss would want. Paul also uses the same word in Romans 6:13. He says, do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead. And so we see that word used there, and what Paul does here is sort of flesh it out in this passage as to what that means. Now notice, he says that we are to present ourselves to God. We are to take ourselves and present ourselves to God to put ourselves at his disposal. And we're to do this as living sacrifices, as a living sacrifice. Now that's an oxymoron. I think I've talked about oxymorons here before, but I'm going to do it again. An oxymoron is not a stupid bovine. That is a moronic ox. There's a difference, right? Okay. And so this is an oxymoron because sacrifices, animal sacrifices in the Old Testament, by nature were killed, not only for our God, but for a foreign God, for a pagan God as well. They're killed. And yet we are to be so turned over to him, to be living out our lives for him, in service to him, being rendered unto him. And yet we live. And so we just don't do it once. We go on and on. Elizabeth Riley Hanford, in a great little free verse poem, taken from a book entitled Me Obey Him, asks and answers, what is a living sacrifice? She says, a life put on the altar with no more will or desire than a dead animal, to be consumed in the service of God. A heart's attitude of absolute, unqualified surrender, to desire nothing the Lord does not desire, to feel no lack, defend no rights, expect no rewards except the joy of serving the one who gave his life for you. We're to be living sacrifices. Here's the thing about a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice can get up off the altar and walk away. And what I want to suggest is that basically every time we sin, that's what we do. We get up off the altar of being turned over to God, and we walk away from him for a time being. It might be just a few moments. And then hopefully we get back on the altar. That's the right thing to do. So we are to be living sacrifices. To be a living sacrifice is acceptable to God, means it's pleasing to him. And this is our spiritual worship. The word spiritual is a great word. It actually means to be carefully thought through on something. It has a cognitive aspect to it, but it's not just being a brainiac on some things. It has a rational, I know things, but there's also a sense of warm-heartedness associated with it. That's what this word encompasses, all of that. Having knowledge of something, but hanging on to it with sincerity and doing it with sincerity. So this is what we're supposed to be doing. To serve God should involve our minds done in a sincere, warm, and affectionate way toward him. Now, I'm going to stop here just for a second before I go on. If we have an imperative verb here, or a virtual imperative, that we are to present ourselves to God, I want to ask you, have you? Can you think of a time in your life where you said, God, I am going to put myself on the altar to serve you? Now, none of us is ever going to do that perfectly. We're not going to do that absolutely. And yet I think we need to be making decisions so that we can start a trajectory in our life of real and significant, intelligent service to God. But if we haven't done that, then we're not quite where we should be, because Paul says we should. Now, I did that. You know, they tell you when you learn how to preach, you should never, ever use yourself as a hero of an illustration. Well, I'm going to give you an example of something I did. On October 7th, 1972, I'd been saved just a little while, I was active in a campus life group at the high school that I attended. They had a retreat up at Whidbey Island for all the campus life clubs throughout the Seattle area. All these hundreds and hundreds of high school kids went up. And I went up too, just a few months after I got saved. And I don't remember what the speaker on that Saturday night talked about, but after it was over, I left sort of the buildings that were there where the conference was being held, and I walked out to the edge of the camp. And remember, now it's pitch dark. And there was a ditch at that part of the road, ran around the whole perimeter of the camp. And I went up to the ditch, and I just laid down in the ditch. And it was amazing, even though it was the Pacific Northwest, the ditch was dry. That never happens. That was a miracle. But I laid down in the ditch for about 45 minutes. And to the best of my knowledge, I don't recall that I'd ever read Romans chapter 12 at that point. I was saved when this happened 85 days. And I just said, Lord, I really want to serve you. I really want to be close to you. Would you please help me to do that? That night, I was wearing my Letterman's jacket. Which I kept. I'm astonished to discover it has shrunken over the years. Now, I got a Letterman's jacket in college as well, for what it's worth. Played football and ran track. But I didn't keep that one. I kept this one. It's in my closet. Whenever I go in to get out a pair of pants or a shirt, I see this every day, all the time. And I don't always think of that night where I laid in the ditch, but quite often I do. And I remember that a 17-year-old kid put himself on the altar of God. Now, you don't have to go lay in a ditch, but I want to ask you, if you haven't, as a deliberate, conscious act, said, okay, Lord, you got to help me to be with you and to serve you better, then it's time for us to do that. Here's what I want to suggest. That between now and the end of the year, so what do you got, like 4 days or something, 3 days, a couple days? You get alone with the Lord and tell him that as best you can with his help, you want to put yourself on his altar to be consumed and used by him. And what I also want to suggest is that when you get alone to do this with him, that you keep some sort of memento to remind you of a commitment that you've made to do that. So if you go to a Starbucks, that's probably not the most quiet and contemplative place to be. Keep the cup or the napkin or something. If you go down to the shore, take home a little scoop of sand. Put it out somewhere that you'll see it regularly as a reminder that you've presented yourself to God. Something that we should all do. That's the first thing that Paul says we ought to be doing. Here's the second thing. He says we need to be transformed in our minds. He goes on to say, do not be conformed to this world. Again, now we have a command. This is a true command verb. We are not to be conformed. Now here comes some more grammar. Do not be conformed. That's a passive verb. So what I want you to understand is that we have a command verb, but it's in the passive voice. Here's the difference between a passive voice and an active voice. Active voice, I hit the ball. Hit, active voice verb. If I say I was hit by the ball, passive voice verb. The action's being done to me. I'm not doing the action. And so what we have here is an imperative verb that is binding upon us, but it's in the active voice. And so what does that mean? It does not say, Paul does not say, transform yourselves. He does say, be transformed. And so I take it that the transformation here happens to us from the Lord, but inasmuch as it's a command, we have to yield ourselves to that process. We have to cooperate with him. We need to keep ourselves on the altar so that he begins to transform us and to change us. This word in verse 2, don't be conformed to this world. Interesting word. It means to take and mold and shape something so that it looks like what it is not. And that sounds kind of strange, doesn't it? If I set a big old chunk of clay up here and I mold it and shape it to look like Ron Frailer or something, it might look like Ron, but it's not Ron. And so here's the thing. What the world does is it comes and it carves on us and it molds us and it shapes us so that we look like what we are not. Well, what are we not? We are not mere worldlings. We are not non-Christians. But the world begins to shape us so we look like non-Christians. And we have a command here to not allow that to happen. What's the opposite? The flip side of that is, instead, we are to be transformed by the renewal of our mind. We get the word metamorphosis from this verb. And so again, another command verb, but another passive voice. I take it that the idea is that we are to put ourselves in a position and to cooperate with God as he is crafting us to be more and more like his son, to be more and more holy. And I take it that we do that by obedience to his word, by using the Christian disciplines like prayer and worship and reading the Bible. As a way that as we do those things, God then can begin to change us to be like who we are. Guys, I would venture to say that every single one of us feels the pull of the world. Do we not? I mean, the world is there to try to make us look like it, when in fact we need to look more like Jesus. We are not worldlings, but we let the world press us into its mold. So how do we do that? How do we renew our minds? Let me make several suggestions here. We need to actually be involved in being in the Word. We need to absorb the Word of God. Now, you know, we're here at Harvest Bible Chapel, right? Bible is our middle name. And I'm so happy to be associated with Harvest because I love the Bible too. Guess what? We have to know the Bible, and we have to know it well enough so that when we look at things that we could be doing, if we look at ways where we could pattern our lives, that we are able to understand the world well enough and the Word well enough to know when the world is telling us to do something that is not scriptural. I mean, one of the things that I was really discouraged to hear about, my wife had a conversation this last week with somebody who seemed to think that it's a Christian, is a Christian person, who seemed to think that it was okay that if you were involved in a really meaningful relationship with somebody of the opposite gender, that it was okay to have sexual relations before you get married. Now, I'm here to tell you, having been a professor at Moody, and I never talked to students about this, but some of my colleagues did. They heard that all the time. Here's the thing. That's not right. Why do we even debate those kinds of questions anymore? Why do we begin to think that way anymore as Christian people? So we shouldn't. That idea comes straight from the world. And we better know the scriptures well enough to be able to recognize it as a counterfeit that comes from the world, as something wrong and sinful. We have to become more discerning. That's another aspect of this. In my experience, some of the most undiscerning people in the world are Christians. We sort of go through our lives and Jesus is just all right with me, and we look at the world and we like stuff in the world and we just sort of, you know, go merrily on our way, and we shouldn't do that. We have to be more discerning. Somebody has said that an open mind is like an open window. You got to put a screen on to keep the bugs out. And most of us don't have much of a screen. Many of us don't. And so we have to know the word well enough to recognize when the word comes along. I have to know the word well enough to recognize when the world comes along and tries to mess us up. Finally, we have to realize as well that it's the Spirit who does this transforming. He's the one who's going to change us. So we need to present ourselves to God. We need to be transformed in our minds to cooperate with the Lord, with the Spirit as he's working on us, to put ourselves in a position that he can do this better and faster. And he goes on in verse 12 to say, we're to be transformed by the renewal of our mind, that by testing you may discern what the will of God, what is the will of God, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. The word prove here means to test the quality of something, to run an analysis on it and to evaluate and to test it out and see that it's good. As we are being transformed by the renewal of our minds, we will be inclined to try out Scripture. We'll be inclined to go do what Scripture says. As the Lord is working on us, we'll go to the Word. Some of you have friends who were Christians for a long time, and they walked away from the Lord. I'm here to tell you, they are not testing and trying out and finding the value of the Word of God. Do you know why? It's because they're not being transformed in their minds. As we are being transformed, we're going to test out the Word. We're going to be seeing that, in fact, it is astonishingly beneficial for us. And that's the word good. So by testing, you may discern what the will of God is. The will of God, by the way, for Paul would have come through prophets and apostles. But for us, we have it written down now in the book that you're holding. The will of God is his revealed will. It's Scripture. So that you may discern what is the will of God. And then he describes it as good. The word good here means that which is morally beneficial. Acceptable means that which is pleasing. Now notice it doesn't say acceptable to God. It just says acceptable. I want to suggest that when we are in the Word and the Lord is transforming us to be more and more like his Son, and we test the Word out and we see how grand it is, we're going to be pleasing God, but we're going to be pleasing other people as well. And I'm not talking about being a people pleaser, but there are things that's right things for us to do, to serve other people and to be a blessing to them and to help them. And we're going to find also that as we do this, it's going to be a blessing for ourselves. It's going to be pleasing for everybody all the way around. And the reason for that is because it is complete. The word complete here means that which is perfect, lacking in nothing. So, let me just ask, what have you done to put yourself on the altar? I want to close with another little story from when I was a kid. When I was about 10, and my brother was about 8, we had reason to be taken by my parents down to the waterfront in Seattle of Puget Sound. Seattle's not on the ocean, but it's on a big inlet from the ocean called Puget Sound. And on the waterfront in Seattle was this really interesting, strange, quirky little souvenir shop called the Ye Old Curiosity Shop. And all my friends had been there, and they all bought stuff there that was all cool. So my brother and I had a chance to go there. My mom and dad took us down, and they allowed us to shop. And my brother and I both bought little tiki heads. Now, you got to remember, I was not a Christian at the time. I would not buy a tiki head now, and I was not reared in a Christian home. But we bought these tiki heads, these wood tiki heads, and they were on kind of a leather string and everything. And we thought those were really cool, so my mom and dad bought them for us. And so we're walking around the house with our tiki heads around our neck thinking, this is really cool. And about 3 weeks later, my brother was getting his down from the shelf and dropped it, and it hit the corner of another shelf, and it chipped it. And you know what we found? The tiki head wasn't made of wood. It was made of plaster of Paris, painted to look like wood. Somebody had taken that, shaped it, formed it, painted it to make it look like what it wasn't. It was plaster of Paris, but it looked like wood. Guys, as we've already said, the world will come along and try to make you not look like a Christian. We have to be aware of that. We have to fight against that. And so I think everything is open for evaluation that we would do in our lives. The next vacation that we're planning, could it be that maybe one of these years and taking a nice fancy vacation, maybe instead, and that's something, by the way, that worldlings might do. I'm not suggesting that Christians should never take a vacation. But maybe once every 4 or 5 years, instead of a fancy vacation, let's go on a short-term missions trip. Instead of buying some really fantastic luxury car, let's buy a loaded Ford and give the money away. Let's do some of those kinds of things different from the world, because that's the right thing for us to do in response to all that God has done for us through his son. You guys got it? If you got it, just say, I got it. Let's pray. So, Father, here we are. We want to present ourselves to you. We don't want to look like the world. It's not such a good place to be, really, because it's so much more pleasing to you and to us to walk with you, that your revealed will is perfect. So, Father, I pray that as best we can, with the help of your Spirit, that you would help us to put ourselves on the altar and to be yours all the time as best we can. That's what we want, Father, but it's hard. So here we are on the cusp of a new year. I want to pray that every single one of us takes a step forward in our relationship with you, and we become better living sacrifices. And Father, that can start right here, right now. The world doesn't give money to you, but we do. We're supposed to. And as we do it, we can have great joy in knowing that you use this to bring glory to yourself and good to other people. So Father, as we give right now, I pray that you'd help us to do it cheerfully and sacrificially and generously, because this is part of what it means to be a living sacrifice. Make it so, Lord, would you please, in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said.